Hello, I'm Miss Kilbenbond. In this video, I'm going to talk to you about the poem Kamikaze by Beatrice Garland. It would help if you had the copy of the poem in front of you, your anthology maybe, and some pens, highlighters. So if you need to pause the video and get yourself organised, do so now. So the learning objectives of this video is to read through and help you understand the feelings and attitudes in the poem Kamikaze by Beatrice Garland. And that's for assessment objective one, in which you just really need to show that you can understand pretty much what the poem is about. But to then dig a little bit deeper for assessment objective two, we're going to look at how you can explore and analyse the effect of language, of form and structure. So think about what techniques is the poet using to try and get those ideas across. And then finally, we're going to investigate the poem's context and how this impacts on meaning. So what can we find out about why Garland might have written this poem, what she might have been thinking about, what might have been happening around her, and how that helps us get even more out of understanding the poem. So let's just start checking that we all understand that term kamikaze, because that's our title of the poem. During the Second World War, the term kamikaze was used for Japanese fighter pilots who were sent on suicide missions. So basically, they were expected to crash their warplanes into enemy warships, Allied warships, usually American ships in the Pacific. So the word kamikaze literally translates as divine wind, and these pilots were sent out in the spirit of divine winds, God on their side, certainly the emperor on their side, and expected to sacrifice themselves in the name of helping support the Japanese war effort. And if that interests you, there's an awful lot you can find out about this particular part of warfare in the Second World War online.
With the homeland in danger of invasion, the Japanese high command turns to a desperate new tactic. On the 25th of November 1944, a lone Japanese bomber closes in on the USS Essex. Its pilot is part of a new force, the Special Attack Corps, Kamikaze.
Today, Japan is desperate. The American Pacific Fleet, backed by powerful British units, is taking fearful toll of enemy aircraft. Japan's answer is the use of a new weapon, kamikazes. Suicide pilots who dive squarely into Allied ships to sink them. Japan's growing desperation is reflected in this fanatical sacrifice of pilots and aircraft in a crazy attempt to hold the Allies off. Jap newsreels in our hands take us inside Japan, revealing the story behind the kamikazes. The Japanese, long trained to blind obedience and worship of the emperor, teach their children that ceremonial suicide is one of the greatest acts of which man is capable. Kamikaze pilots are men trained for death. Nearly all the suicide pilots are between 16 and 20 years old. Celebrations are held to honor them when their training is finished. Prayers are said, and they need them, for they're already as good as dead. The prettiest geisha girls entertain them. Their pictures appear in Japanese newspapers as national heroes. Garbed in ceremonial robes, their heads are shaved except for a small patch of hair. During their last few days of life, they walk solemnly through the streets. They're ready for their mission of death. This is their big day. To cries of Banzai, they prepare for their last flight, which may destroy an Allied ship.
Now, to dig a little bit deeper into that, it's also useful to think, well, what can we find out about Japanese culture that might explain why so many Japanese pilots were willing to put themselves forward to sacrifice themselves in this way? And this goes back a long time in Japanese history to something you might be familiar with from films, the idea of the way of the warrior and the code of the samurai soldier. So we've got this word Bushido, which means exactly that, the way of the warrior, this code of the samurai, where it was stressed that they had to have unquestioning loyalty and obedience, that they should value honour above their own life. And that has been for a long, long time, a really important part of Japanese culture, and helps to explain why there would be so much pressure and honour to go ahead with one of these suicide missions. And that's going to be important when we look at the poem. It's also useful just to be aware of this word seppuku, which is a form of taking one's own life that was considered to be honourable among the Japanese samurai. So traditionally, this meant, it's a bit gruesome, I'm afraid, but stabbing yourself in the abdomen, in the stomach, and in doing that, this seppuku was done to basically demonstrate your bravery, your self-control, your willpower, your sincerity, your absolute commitment to putting your own life after your honour and your patriotism, your love of your country. And when we put those two things together, you can see that it's really deeply rooted and important to Japanese culture by the time we get to the Second World War, that this behaviour of being a kamikaze pilot makes a lot more sense. And obviously Beatrice Garland, as a poet, would have researched this and made sure that she understood this before writing a poem about one of these pilots.
800kgの爆弾を抱えて 飛び出しまして血の気が引くような思いをしましたから死んでもその任務を達成するんだと。まもなく皆さん突っ込んできますからね。もう覚悟してても、いざ特攻隊に編成ということになりますとね、建前は国のためということですけども、自分のその愛する 父派、兄弟姉妹のために自己犠牲するのは、これはもう当時の戦況からしてやむを得ないんだということを、それぞれのパイロットが自分に納得させましてね、その時の、なんていうんですか、例えに散る桜
残る桜も散る桜という言葉がありましてね。いや、死んでもその任務を達成してほしいんだというところに、任務達成というのが一番その中で僕は価値がある目的だったと。
So we're going to listen to a reading of the poem now. Once that reading finishes, then I'd like you to pause the video and make sure that you read it a couple more times yourself, because when you read a poem once, it never really sticks in the same way as when you let it soak in by reading it a couple of times.
Kamikaze by Beatrice Garland. Her father embarked at sunrise with a flask of water, a samurai sword in the cockpit, a shaven head full of powerful incantations, and enough fuel for a one-way journey into history. But halfway there, she thought, recounting it later to her children, he must have looked far down at the little fishing boats strung out like bunting on a green-blue translucent sea. And beneath them, arcing in swathes like a huge flag, waved first one way, then the other, in a figure of eight, the dark shoals of fishes, flashing silver as their bellies swiveled towards the sun, and remembered how he and his brothers, waiting on the shore, built cairns of pearl-grey pebbles to see whose withstood longest the turbulent inrush of breakers, bringing their father's boat safe, yes, grandfather's boat, safe to the shore, salt-sodden, awash with cloud-marked mackerel, black crabs, feathery prawns, the loose silver of white bait, and once a tuna, the dark prince, muscular, dangerous. And though he came back, my mother never spoke again in his presence, nor did she meet his eyes. And the neighbours too, they treated him as though he no longer existed. Only we children still chattered and laughed, till gradually we too learned to be silent, to live as though he had never returned, that this was no longer the father we loved. And sometimes, she said, he must have wondered which had been the better way to die.
So we've talked a little bit about the title already. It's always important to look at the title of a poem because it can help frame the meaning of the poem and give it a sort of concrete base on which you can then build what else is happening. So we know we've got this Japanese word. We know that it refers to a very specific time in history and the actions of those pilots. We're going to look actually at the end of the poem a little bit more about Beatrice Garland and why she might have written about kamikaze. Initially, I just want us to focus on that one word and what we know it means, what we've learnt about the culture of Japan and how that helps us understand the pressure that a pilot would have been under to perform this task. So let's just think about the poem generally and what we can say first of all about its form. It's a poem that's written in free verse. That means there's no strict rhyming scheme, there's no regular rhythm that we can talk about. And what that enables us to see from this poem is it's reported speech. So what that means is it's the report of a speaker or a writer on the words that are spoken or written or thought by somebody else. So in this poem, we have reported speech that belongs to the daughter of the pilot. Now, what's interesting about this poem, but what can be confusing unless you spend some time to think about it first, is that there's a lot of shifting between narrators in this poem, and it's not difficult, you just need to make sure you've thought it through before you think in the poem in any more detail. Because what we have is a poem that moves between the first person perspective and a third person perspective. It's the tale told by the pilot's daughter at the beginning of the poem. She's a character in the poem, and the speaker, who we don't know who the speaker is talking about the daughter and how she thinks about her father's story. But then as we get further down towards the end of the poem, we notice that we shift into the first person speaker. We have a change of narrator, and it's like we're listening to the thoughts of that daughter who's talking about her own father and how she tells the story about him to her children. So as we go through, be thinking about which voice are we listening to, and just be aware that there is a change of voice, which is unusual, however, is clever, and we'll talk about what that actually achieves. So let's look at the start of our poem then. Her father embarked at sunrise with a flask of water, a samurai sword in the cockpit, a shaven head full of powerful incantations, and enough fuel for a one-way journey into history. So as I was saying just now, we start off with this third person narrative perspective. So her father. So we're concentrating on the daughter and her father being the kamikaze pilot. And what we find out is that her father embarked at sunrise, and then we start to learn that he heads off on his journey as a pilot making that suicide mission. Now what this achieves is it distances the pilot from the outset. So immediately, even in those first stanzas, the pilot seems a very distant figure to us as the reader, because we're seeing the father, the pilot, through a story about his daughter. And that's clever because it actually foreshadows that he is going to be dismissed in some way, that he's already an outcast, that he's somebody who it's hard for us to reach. And that's exactly what history has done to this pilot, the fact that he's shamed by the end, that nobody wants to talk to him. As the reader, that kind of happens to us as well. We never really get to know truly what was going on in his mind, so it's a really clever technique. Her father embarked at sunrise. Now, sorry to stop again so quickly, but sunrise is really significant because if we think about the symbolism of the Japanese flag and the importance of sunrise to Japanese culture, then the fact that her father's embarking at sunrise starts to really strongly ground the start of this pilot's day in everything that's seen as powerful about Japanese nationalism. The rising sun is a symbol of Japanese nationalism, and through this poem, the strength and pressure that the pilot was put on by Japanese patriotism, by the expectations of how much loyalty he should have to his emperor, is really powerful. And it starts with this image of sunrise. Her father embarked at sunrise with a flask of water, a samurai sword in the cockpit, a shaven head full of powerful incantations. Now again, the things that he has got in his cockpit with him are also very important to our understanding, and the connotations of these objects are really important. So we start with the flask of water, which, you know, sounds like a sensible thing to have with you, but immediately that's followed by the samurai sword. So we've talked already about the Bushido, the way of the warrior, the importance of the samurai history, and the connotation of a samurai soldier as being this absolutely brave, fearsome fighter who would rather kill himself than give up his honour for his country. So having that sword alongside something as normal and essential as a flask of water is absolutely making sure that as the reader we're getting the sense that this is a man who's under huge nationalistic pressure to perform in a certain way, because those samurai soldiers, and that would have then translated into the pilots in the Second World War, were expected to have certain values that were absolutely rooted in duty, in loyalty, in self-control, and this idea that honour is more important than your life. So with his sword in the cockpit, this symbol of everything that Japanese warrior way of life stands for, he also has a shaven head full of powerful incantations. So they would, all the pilots had to have a shaven head. That was kind of part of the one of the things that had to be done before they could go on their suicide mission. But his head is full of powerful incantations because he has also had to be mentally prepared for what he's about to do. And this again is showing us the power of patriotism, that he was trained to have these mental affirmations, these mental incantations, sort of chants, if you like, to make sure that he had the strength to go through with this. Because everything as a human is going to pull away from suicide, yet the psychological pull that's been drilled into him of dying honourably, of that honour to the families of those who sacrificed themselves, that if you die honourably, your family will be seen as heroic for all time afterwards, is so powerful. It's something that they keep repeating, so they've got the strength to go through with this. I've not mentioned yet the assonance that we can also see here. So assonance are sounds, not necessarily at the beginning of words, like with alliteration, but the sounds from vowels between the consonants, so the vowel sounds that come up across words. So we've got father, at, flask, water, samurai. So lots of words here that give this a very methodical sound, and that's all reflecting the commitment that this pilot had for his mission and the things that he had to go through before he was able to take off. So with these powerful incantations in his head, his sword and his water, he only has enough fuel for a one-way journey into history. He's got his head full of powerful incantations and enough fuel. Those two words, that alliteration, is very similar. Assonant signs of full and fuel, very deliberate, pulling those words together there. Those are the things that he needs. He only needs enough fuel for a one-way journey because the expectation is that he won't be coming back. And if we look at his one-way journey, it's a one-way journey into history. So metaphorically, this journey is going to make history, because it's going to make history for his country is the hope, and also he's going to become history as the expectation is that he will die. Another thing you'll notice about this poem is that there are very few full stops, and this enjambement that we have here between stanza 1 and stanza 2 is all part of creating this very restless state of mind, sort of reflecting how that pilot's thinking. There's something very restless about the poem where we're sort of waiting for the full stop to come and it doesn't. And that also reflects the general restlessness of the daughter and the guilt that she seems to have for the way her father's story panned out, and also for the pilot himself, who obviously is under immense stress at this time, and creating that same sort of feeling for the reader just helps to create an atmosphere that suits the meaning of this poem. So into stanza 2 then, but, and we see that word but, and we immediately know there's something that's going to shift and change here. But halfway there, she thought, recounting it later to her children. So let's just stop there, because again we've got this clever narrative technique here where we're still with our unknown speaker in third person who's focusing on the daughter. And what we find out here, this shift, is that this daughter of the pilot can only think and guess what her father might have been thinking, recounting it later to her children. We find out that she is telling a story to her children later in the future after the war, but there's no certainty even for the pilot's daughter that she can actually make sense of what happened on this day that the pilot went out on this mission. And those shifts in time and shifts in speaker are all part of telling a story where there's so many unanswered questions. By the time we get to the end of the poem, we realise that there are so many unanswered questions because the pilot was never given that chance to explain his thoughts. It's all been left to guesswork and guilt and misunderstanding of the pressure that he was under. So she's sort of guessing that what must have happened to the pilot as he started to leave Japan and look down on the coastline behind him. He must have looked far down at the little fishing boat strung out like bunting on a green, blue, translucent sea. So this is the daughter imagining what that pilot must have seen as he was flying away. And it's like a bird's eye view where he looks down on his life, which is also very symbolic, the idea that he's kind of above his life in some way and looking down on what things mean to him. And what he looks at is actually a natural scene, if you like, a kind of scene that's very normal and reflects his life and his childhood and his family life, how he's grown up. The little fishing boat, so everything seems tiny compared to him looking down on it, strung out like bunting. So we've got the simile there, reflecting the idea of bunting, which we'd have connotations of being kind of happy, something you might see at a fair, on a green, blue, translucent sea. So we've got lots of alliteration here as well, and that alliteration is matching the things that are beautiful that he would have looked down on. So we've got the boats and the bunting and the blue, we've got the strung and the sea, and if we think about sound, then those sounds that are being emphasised are all positive things that he would have looked down as seen a natural beauty in the place that he's about to leave behind. And beneath them, arcing in swathes like a huge flag waved first one way, then the other in a figure of eight, the dark shoals of fishes. So, as well as this beautiful green blue sea and the bunting and the boats, we now start to look more at the natural world that he's leaving behind. And the pilot, his daughter imagines, would have been looking down and would see these dark shoals of fishes who are moving as if they're in a figure of eight. Now look really closely at the simile that has been used by Beatrice Garland to describe the fish and the way they're moving. Arcing in swathes like a huge flag, waved first one way, then the other in a figure of eight. Now again, really clever, because we know that this poem is, a lot of it is about the pressure and the power of patriotism, of nationalistic pride. So to compare the movement of the fish to being like a huge flag waved first one way, then the other. Remember, we had that image of the sunrise at the beginning that links to the flag of Japan. He's all bringing to the fore, bringing to our thoughts this idea of nationalistic pride again. It's a really clever simile, because what she's actually describing there is he looked down and what he sees isn't actually about patriotism and his duty to the emperor. He actually looks down and he sees something that's from the natural world as a thing of beauty and has been important to his childhood. So lots of things going on there, and those dark shoals of fishes flashing silver as their bellies swiveled towards the sun. So we've got that sibilance there, all those sounds, and that brightens the poem. It reflects the sight of what he's seeing. There's lots of sensory imagery in this poem, and what happens is that this natural world is reflected as something that's very positive. It's a trigger for his childhood memories, and when we read the poem a couple of times, we realise that the suggestion is that as he looks down on this natural world and the memories from his childhood that it makes him remember, there's a realisation that it's love that gives his life meaning. It's not honour, it's not patriotism, it's actually love and joy and those things that he remembers from memory, the power of memory. So we're still on this sort of linear journey at the moment where he's looking out of his plane and remembering these things as we go on to the next stanza. Remembered how he and his brothers, waiting on the shore, built cairns of pearl-grey pebbles to see whose withstood longest the turbulent inrush of breakers. So the power of memory, the power of family, is being given strength in this poem. The power of childhood innocence, a time when war and conflict and the pressures of patriotism are not part of his life experience at all. So he remembers, as he is in his plane looking down, he remembers how he used to play with his brothers a really innocent game of building cairns out of stones on the shore. And again, we've got the colours are so powerful throughout this poem. To see who's withstood longest the turbulent inrush of breakers. So who could build a little tower of pebbles and whose would last the longest before the waves knocked it down again. So really innocent, normal childhood joy. And then he remembers bringing their father's boat safe. The same waves that were trying to knock over their cairns were the waves that brought back their father's boat safe. And then we go on to the next stanza. Yes, grandfather's boat, safe to the shore. So we have this interruption now. If you see in the italics there, yes, grandfather's boat, where we're suddenly thrown back into the daughter and her story as she's telling her children in the middle of what's the pilot's supposed memory. So there's lots of playing around with time and narrator here, which just reminds us of this very unsure journey in terms of trying to unpick what might have happened to the pilot. What's important, what I'd like you to look at though, is that repetition of the word safe. The childhood memory is of the father of the pilot, who presumably is a fisherman, who comes back safe from going out in the boat. And then we have the repetition of the word safe again. Interesting when we're talking about a poem that's based in conflict and a pilot who's going out essentially on a suicide mission. So I think that repetition of safe is quite deliberate there and brings something else to the poem. So yes, grandfather's boat, safe to the shore, salt sodden, awash with cloud-marked mackerel, black crabs, feathery prawns, the loose silver of whitebait. So what the grandfather has brought back in the fishing boat has been a range of fish, but look at all the sensory image that's used to describe them again. So we've got the salt sodden, awash with cloud-marked mackerel, black crabs, feathery prawns, the loose silver of whitebait. There's loads of colour again here. There's also taste and smell, and there's also alliteration and sibilance again. So we've got the sort of sound of the sea, the safe, the shore, the salt sodden, the silver, and then we've got these colours and tastes and smells, the salt sodden again, the cloud mark, the black, the feathery texture, the silver of the whitebait. And all of these things are creating this really vivid beauty and wealth of the natural world, and the natural world becomes timeless and powerful and much more closely linked with the desire to live than with any duty to an emperor or a culture. But as we get to the end of this first sentence, and this really is the end of the first sentence in the poem, even though we're so far down it on the page, we get this more dark image again, a tuna, the dark prince, muscular, dangerous. Now, to catch a tuna would have been a prize catch because it's such a powerful fish and so difficult to haul in. But it becomes a metaphor. It becomes the dark prince. So prince having obvious links to royalty and power and things that perhaps then can remind us of the emperor who's sitting above this poem, and is the duty to the emperor is what would have made these kamikaze pilots feel like they had to go ahead with their mission. Using this metaphor to compare the tuna to the dark prince changes the tone of the poem. It sort of takes a tragic turn. It starts to talk about something dangerous, perhaps a heightened sense of sadness and even perhaps a link to death. And it comes really nicely at a point in the poem where everything changes again, and now we shift to the first person narrator, that is the daughter of the pilot. So here we go, the last two stanzas of the poem, and now we are more closely associating with the daughter. And though he came back, my mother never spoke again in his presence, nor did she meet his eyes. And the neighbours too, they treated him as though he no longer existed. So this is the really tragic conclusion to this poem. So Garland shows us through the voice of the daughter that when this pilot turned his plane round and came back, that he brought so much shame on the family that even his own wife refused to speak to him again, as did the neighbours. So he ends up being denied the love of his family that motivated his decision to turn round. It's ironic because everything suggests it was love for his family, it was powerful family memories, it was the vivid wealth of nature and the beautiful world in which he lived that made him turn round. But when he turns back, he ends up losing the love of all of that that he turned round for. The neighbours treat him as though he no longer existed. So the patriotism of those neighbours is so powerful that even though he presumably was a friend, they no longer treat him as a friend. In fact, they treat him as if he no longer exists. Only we children still chattered and laughed. So we've got this playful sound here, the children, the chattered, so some more alliteration there, the laughing of the children. But look what happens next. Till gradually we too learned to be silent. So very deliberately, we've got the chattering and the laughing then suddenly disappearing, and we have the emphasis on that word silent, to live as though he had never returned, that this was no longer the father we loved. And it is not much more tragic than that idea, that even his own children learn to ignore him and to not give him any acknowledgement that he even exists. And we've got another full stop there. That's actually the end of the second sentence in the poem. There are only three sentences in this poem, and each sentence represents a sort of time and a narrative shift. So if you think about it like that, it can help you to organise how you might want to think about talking and discussing the poem and what it means. So our last sentence is our shortest sentence and is just the last final two lines of the poem. And sometimes, she said. So again, we've got a flip to the narrator again. We're back to sort of the third person speaker looking in on what the daughter's saying to her children. And sometimes, she said, he must have wondered which had been the better way to die. So what we then find out from the daughter is this sense that she has also now lived with an internal conflict. There's a sense that she has shame and regret for the way that she treated her father, the way that everyone treated her father, and she can't do anything about that anymore except for try and explain to her children what happened. So there's a sense of that loss at the end of this poem, and it cleverly changes in sound as well, because at the end of the poem it slips into regular metre. So what that means is that the rhythm of the poem changes, and it actually takes on this sort of resigned, very sad, very melancholic, inevitable conclusion, where we get a real sense that there's nothing else that can be done. It's a sombre end to the poem that sounds very definite, and that nothing can ever be done to go back and give that pilot any love or respect. So it's very unsettling. So what we've seen is a daughter trying to put herself in her father's position, telling the story to try and give this idea that the family theme, the theme of family, is central to the whole poem. And we see that there's a conflict in this poem between the personal and the national duty. There's a conflict between individual desire and extreme patriotism. And all of these things are kind of going head to head in this poem, and there is no happy conclusion to how that worked out. It's ironic that this pilot returned out of love, lost his honour, and in turn lost the love of his family that he came back for. And that's the true tragedy of the poem. Now, I want to return now to thinking about the context of the poem. So at the beginning, we talked a lot about the Japanese culture and how a kamikaze pilot is based on a history of samurai soldiers and their code of honour. But actually, what Beatrice Garland has revealed in interviews about this poem is that whilst it is a poem about the Japanese kamikaze, what inspired her to write this poem is actually a more modern story of conflict. And that is the attack on the Twin Towers. So the terrorist attack on the Twin Towers in New York, which happened in her lifetime and would have had a profound effect on her, as it did to all of us who lived through that time, and even now it has changed so many things about the world. So you can see now on the screen some of the front page news articles following that event. Now, as a poet, as a human, Beatrice Garland watched this play out on the news, and it changed things for her, and she became quite fixated by the idea of what could have driven these people, these terrorists, to go on a suicide mission and cause so much death and destruction to the people who were working in the Twin Towers and elsewhere in America. So this is what she has said in an interview about this. What really set me off with this poem was the destruction of the Twin Towers, 9/11. For me and my generation, that was the most shattering event, and one of the things I found most extraordinary about it was there were young men in the prime of their lives who were willing to destroy themselves and other people, of course, in the service of a cause that they believed passionately in. I wanted to know, what is it that will make somebody willing to blow themselves up in the service of a cause? So that's her original initial inspiration for how this poem ended up. I started to research it, and one of the most notorious examples are kamikaze pilots. I find a very interesting difference. All the young men in Japan were, of course, ordered to do so by the Emperor of Japan, and that, I think, is very different to today's young terrorists. Human beings are very given to fight each other for power, for money, for prestige, so that's the bigger conflict, war. But there's also the more private conflict. Do I do this or don't I? And that's the sort of conflict that every human being faces. I would say every day. This is what a human being is. We have the opportunity to consider these decisions before we make them. It seems to me entirely reasonable that some of these young men will have thought, what are we doing this for? So she goes on to then say that when the pilot's shunned by the family and neighbours at the end of the poem, that this is a very subtle and poisonous conflict because they just do not engage with him. He's cut off from everything that gives life meaning. The decision to do something you think is right or not to do something you think is wrong is immensely powerful. That is your personal power. You can say no. Do I think he, and she's talking about the pilot, regretted it? No. It was the right thing to do. It's quite unusual to be able to hear the voice of the poet in terms of what motivated her, what she was thinking when she wrote that poem. And I hope you find that helps you to look at the poem maybe in a slightly different way, or certainly to reinforce what you were thinking about it. You can see that what Beatrice Garland is interested in is how the human mind could be pressurised into doing something so dramatic and drastic and terrible, yet also in her poem she imagines what would happen if you stepped back from that pressure, and where might that leave you? And that's the conflict, the personal family conflict, that's then the tragedy of this poem. How can we compare this poem to other poems in the anthology? Well, Ozymandias might be a good place to start, because Shelley also uses storytelling to reveal that nature's ultimately powerful. It's not such a strong theme of nature in Kamikaze, but it's absolutely true that it's nature, it's a natural world, is one of the things that, as he's looking down out of his plane, is a pull and a reminder of the things that are important in his life. So that could work as a comparison. In Prelude by Wordsworth, we've got both poets there exploring the vulnerability of humans, and I think that's a really powerful thing that you could pull together from those two poems. In Tennyson's Charge of the Light Brigade, they're two very different explorations of the power of patriotism, one very public and one private, but absolutely both totally centred by the pull of national pride and what that means. And then in Owen's Exposure, we've got isolation as an interesting theme in both poems. The poets resist heroic portrayals of soldiers in conflict, and similar ideas would also make Bayonet Charge by Hughes a good comparison. Then we've got Remains by Armitage. So both poems explore the longer term impact of conflict on an individual, focusing on the consequences of one decision. I think that's a really nice comparison there. And then in Poppies by Weir, both poets look at the domestic perspective of the impact of conflict and patriotism on family relationships. And again, there's so many interesting things that you could do with that. In War Photographer, Sir Duffy's poem, both the soldier and the photographer are outsiders in their own communities as a consequence of conflict. So hopefully you can see that's another strong comparison. And then finally, in The Emigre by Rumens, both poets explore the power and the influence of memory through speakers whose lives have been impacted by conflict. I hope this video has been helpful. You should now be able to think about your understanding of the feelings and the attitudes of the poem Kamikaze by Beatrice Garland, and also be able to pull out quite a few different things about language, form and structure, and then be able to think about how Garland's choices on those things have influenced the way that the poem works, how it creates meaning. And then finally, we've looked at the context of the poem. So we've looked at the fact that it's about the kamikaze pilots and how that influences our understanding of the poem, but also we've been lucky enough to hear Garland's view of what made her write that poem, what her inspiration was, and that hopefully has given you another interesting way through which to read this poem. Thanks for listening.